To this last colloquium of 2018, today's event is devoted to computer science, and Luigi Ambrosio will give a short introduction to our guest. I will just announce that the next event will take place on January 30, and it will be devoted to chemistry. Thank you.
It's a pleasure to introduce here Roberto Di Cosmo. He's an old friend of the time where we were both students of the Scuola Normale. He has been undergraduate here from 82 to 86. Then he did his PhD in computer science in Pisa. And then he had a very fast career, first as a maître conférencier in the Ecole Normale, and then as a professor in the University of Paris Diderot, where he is still now. His research is at the crossroad between functional programming, logic, theory of categories, game theory, and his work has already so many recognitions. In particular, many of his papers have received prestigious awards. And then in 2014, he started this ambitious project about software heritage that will be the theme of his talk. So I'm particularly happy to introduce him. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. So can we have the slide here? Okay. Oh, fantastic, okay. So first of all, let me say that I'm extremely happy to be here. Some 33 years since when I left as a student, coming back to tell you a little bit more what has happened in this period. It's really a pleasure. I mean, let me start with a brief introduction about who I am, because, I mean, 33 years is a long time, so you probably just a few people remember me. So I'm a computer science professor in Paris, as it was said already before. I have spent basically the last 30 years doing research and teaching, so educating the next generation of researchers and engineers in computer science. My research activity was at the beginning really very theoretical. That's the reason why for people who like this kind of game, so my Erdos number is 3, okay, for the mathematicians in the room. But then I moved kind of quickly to more applied thematics, functional programming, in particular more recently to the difficult scientific problem that come up when you start using free and open source software massively, like, because this kind of this is really new and brings to the limelight a lot of new problems that come from the big mass of software which is available. So 20 years ago, I started being involved in everything related to free software and open source, and as a developer, as an advocate, as a theoretician. And then 10 years ago, you know, when you start to grow older, you have some gray beard like me, you start taking over some more responsibilities, so I have built a certain number of infrastructure and institutions to help develop new knowledge related in particular to free software. I mean, so software heritage, which is the subject of the presentation of today, is basically my last big undertaking, but I also recently joined the National Committee for Open Science, which was created last year by the Ministry of Research in France. So you will see there is a connection. Well, okay, so that was just as a presentation. The subject of today is really software and software source code. So if you look around you, you will find software everywhere. We use it all the time, but there are a couple of observations which are really important. First of all, software is not just a tool, it is also an essential mediator for accessing all digital information. This is really new in the history of mankind. For example, look around you. Here you have books, which probably date of many centuries ago. If you open up these books, you probably will still be able to read them and understand what is written in there. Think about our modern society. Take a floppy disk from 1980s. Try to read what is in them. Good luck. Okay, you need to have a reader, you need to have the software to understand what is the meaning of a sequence of bits which are on the disk. This is really new. So software is a mediator for accessing all digital information. And for example, Vinton Cerf, who is one of the co-creators of the internet, several years ago warned everybody of the risk of a kind of digital dark age that may happen if we lose the software that allows us to interpret the digital information that we are all relying on. So this is the first observation. And the second observation is that if you look at the science we are building, all kinds of science or research, including in social sciences and the humanities, today software has become an essential pillar for our research. I mean, you should not trust me. You can have a look here at the, how does this work? Okay. Let's see. No, the other one, okay. So there is a nice article in Nature in October 2014 where somebody took the time to go through the 100 most influential papers published in Nature from the very beginning of the journal, and they found out that the vast majority is describing experimental method and in particular software, which is essential for the research in their particular area. Last week, we had a meeting on this National Committee on Open Science in Paris at the Ministry of Research, and Christine Borgman, who is a professor at UCLA, having studied issues related to data in science for decades, came up with this nice phrase that I'm quoting here. So sometimes, if you don't have the software, you do not have the data that you are using in your scientific research. And there are some people from physics here. I think you know what I'm talking about. Okay. So this is really important. Hence, software is an important part of our knowledge today. But when you talk about knowledge in software, where is this knowledge actually embodied? Okay? Our knowledge and cultural heritage is actually embodied in what we call the source code of the software that we use. So what is the definition of the source code of a piece of software? There is a very nice definition that you can find in the General Public License, which is one of the earliest license for free software, which was developed in the 80s. And the definition is the source code of a program is actually the form of this program which is preferred for a developer for making changes to it. So let me give a very, very trivial example. I beg pardon to everybody that knows this even better than me, but just to give you an explanation. Imagine you take your phone, you launch an application, and this application shows a nice message that says, hello world. Then it happens that you're in Italy, you would like to have the message in Italian, so you call an engineer and tell him, look, can you just change this hello world in buongiorno a tutti? Well, the engineer has two choices. One is to take the running program, try to hack it, basically trying to change this, which is a real expert of the binary that produces this particular message there. And then, you know, I mean, this can be done. When I was a hacker, I was really, I liked a lot to spend my nights in a room not very far from here hacking on software in this particular form, but after a while you get tired. I mean, this is not really the most efficient way of changing things. And then you discover it's much better to get something else which was the original representation that was written by the developer. And there, even if you are not very technical, it is very, very easy to see what you need to change to make the modification. Okay, so that's a source code. You know, the definition is kind of contrived because if you just say, source code is something which is written in the programming language C or in the programming language Java, that is not the source code. This C or Java can be generated by a tool. So the real definition is what the programmer wants to use. And now when you start thinking about the source code, you know, when I was a student here, I read a book by Harold Appleson, which is a professor at MIT, which wrote a very influential book in the 80s called Structure and Interpretation of Computer Programs. And in the introduction, he wrote, programs must be written for people to read in the first place and only accessorily for machines to execute. Well, of course, you will say, this is just a computer science professor telling all the students that if they turn in a homework that he cannot read, they will get a bad grade, which is not wrong. But it is deeper than that. The reason is that you need to be able to read the source code of a program because probably you will need to change it or fix it, and the other person they may need to read it may be you in 2 weeks. So it's better to make it readable. No? So having comments, well, structure, you choose the name of the variable in a proper way. So in 1985, when he wrote this, there was not much source code which was available
to actually make this message really clearly understood. But today, 30 years later, 30 years of free and open source software later, we have millions of pieces of source code lying around, and you can find jewels in them, in this source code which is available. For example, I do not know how many of you remember Quake 3. You know? So Quake 3 is one of these very early games, first-person shooting games. I mean, the late descendant is Call of Duty. I mean, if you have kids of my like me, you know they spend too much time playing this kind of game. So that when it was developed by John Carmack at ID Software in the 90s, there were very, very nice challenges. Like, for example, if you do rendering for 3D images, or actually it was 2.5 dimension at the moment, you need to compute very often a function which is 1/√x. So where is the difficulty? You just call two library functions, one is √x, and the other, which is division by 1. Well, the difficulty was that in the 90s, the numerical coprocessors which are available were not fast enough to perform this operation in such a way that you could play the game. Okay? So it was so slow that you were twirling your joystick, that the gun doesn't move, you are dead, and the game is not fun. Okay? So they needed to find a way around this. And now the source code of Quake 3 Arena is available, and you can find this pretty nifty, fantastic few lines of code in there that compute 1/√x using some very, very nifty tricks. So you see, I will not spend too much time on this, and we'll just refer you to the corresponding Wikipedia page, but it's really nice to see what is going on. So you take a floating point number here, then, can this move? I don't know how to do it. Okay? So what you do, you convert this number into a long integer. You see, and you see the comment, evil floating point bit level hacking. So you are basically taking why is the place where the floating point number, take the address of that, so the position where it is located. Then you tell the C compiler, forget it is a floating point number, look at it as a long integer, and then you take the address again. So now I is just the sequence of 32 bits, which are the representation of the floating point number. Okay. Then something even much more evil is happening here, and you will see it in the comment that I will not read. I mean, the comment that you see there. Okay, so let me hide it a bit. And so basically you shift this floating point, this 32 bits by 1. You remember that's a division by 2. Okay, and then you subtract it to a constant that appears from nowhere. Well, what is happening is that if you remember a 32-bit representation of a floating-point number, there are 8 bits of exponent and 24 bits of mantissa. Okay? The mantissa is a part after the comma. And if you remember, if you want to play a kind of game and finding the √x and 1/√x, take the logarithm. Okay, so if you take the logarithm, basically it is -1/2 of the logarithm of x. And the logarithm of x is almost x when logarithm of 1+x is almost x when x is small. So this is a game which is played here. So you divide it by 2, your basic, and the minus there is an approximation of 1/√x. And this strange constant there is just there to get rid of the exponent and simplify a few elements. So now you get an approximation. You get an approximation of this 1/√x, but it is not precise enough. So these guys are doing some other nifty trick in here. So you say, take the square of it, multiply, manual 3/5. What is going on? There is a comment saying, first iteration. Aha, that's a Newton method. Okay, applied using as a starting point this crazy approximation you got by doing that strange bit manipulation there. And why this is interesting? This is interesting because, you know, the evil floating point bit level hacking, in changing the typecast of on the variable, costs zero at execution time because it is just the same representation. One shift right, this is 1 clock time, okay, no more. Then you have a few integer subtraction and multiplication, And this is extremely faster than doing the floating point operation on the coprocessor. Well, this code is no longer executed. It is inside an ifdef, if you look at the source code today, because modern coprocessors are fast enough to do the operation properly. Okay? But it's a beautiful piece of really genius writing of computer science, the thing that you like. I mean, it is bit-level hacking plus mathematics plus knowledge of the machine and everything to make things work well. And if you want to understand what is going here, you really, really need to have the source code. If you have just the binary, it's impossible to understand what is going on. Here, the source code, even the comments of the line that have disappeared, is important to understand what is going on. You see? And so this is just one of the many examples that one could show, and I like it a lot, but there are a few other ones. So why am I spending time showing you this? Because I want to convince you that the source code of programs is important because it contains knowledge that you cannot recover by just looking at executable and binaries. And actually, if we can go back to the slide, the full slide, no? How do you do this? Okay. There is a nice place in Mountain View in California, which is a computer history museum, where they are trying to rebuild the history of computing. And the director of the board of the computer history museum, Len Schuster, has a nice article written in 2006 where he says that the source code provides a view in the mind of the designer, which is really, really what is happening here. And you know, all this is kind of new, and the reason why I spend time on this is it is just 50 years old. I mean, computing is not that old. And in the 60s, when we sent the first man to the moon, actually, we only managed to do it, to send them there and bring them back, because in the Apollo 11, there was a guidance computer which was running 60,000 lines of code written under the direction of Margaret Hamilton, which is one of probably the most important women in the history of computer science, with Grace Hopper, who invented COBOL, and other people like her. And when she did this 60,000 line of code, there was no book. You didn't know how to write this. I mean, so software that actually works, the trans, which is resilient. And for people who are curious, I had the chance to meet Margaret, and there are a few anecdotes which are really too nice, but I will not say this here. I mean, for the coffee machine later on, if you want. And also, the other thing which is important in this picture that you see, 60,000 lines of code, well, if you really try to print them out, it's a sizable amount of paper. We don't do it anymore. But 50 years later, today, in your pockets, in this phone, for example, in an Android phone, you have a Linux kernel, which is just the kernel, which is running on the bare metal to enable all the other nice applications to say, I love you, can we meet at the cinema at the right time, okay? Just to make it running, you need an operating system. This operating system is today 20 million lines of code, just the small, tiny part which is there. Okay, and so, let me go to the other part. Okay. So this is a general picture, but now I would like to zoom into a particular part, which is science, and open science, what we actually do. So since we are in Pisa, I'm very happy to put a picture of Galileo Galilei. You know, I mean, the scientific and experimental method was invented here. I mean, this is what we say as Italian. If you go to France, where I live today, they tell me, no, it's Descartes, you know, the discours de la méthode. And if you go to England, they tell you, no, it's Bacon. But nevertheless, the important point is that this method basically says that if you are doing science and doing experiments, you make observations, set up an experiment, formulate a hypothesis, develop a theory, and the most important part is that you must be able to reproduce and verify. Because as Karl Popper actually wrote last century, I mean, non-reproducible single occurrences are of no relevance to science. If you have a result, you cannot reproduce it. I remember when I was a student here, there was this issue about the memory of the water. I don't know if somebody remembers it. It was extremely funny. I mean, there was, I'm sure the students today that you have other interesting anecdote to tell, but I mean, somebody, and memory, water has memory, then everybody tried to reproduce it, didn't work, so sorry, it's not science, okay? But what happens today? Today we are in a world where everybody is doing science using computers. And so the scientific method today actually requires a lot. I mean, if you want to reproduce experiments, reproduce, understand science, then you need open access to the article that describes the result, which is a big issue. You need access to the data sets which are used in the experiment described in the article, and you need access to the software that has been used to actually perform the experiment. Yeah? If you take an article and this article said, we have done this kind of manipulation of this data and the result is 42, if you don't have the data and you don't have the software that has been used, it's generally very, very difficult to reproduce experiment. So the first two items, open access and open data sets, are kind of well known, has been discussed for a long time. The open access movement was started 20 years ago. Open data is now even mandatory. If you have a European project accepted, we probably know that in the paperwork you need to provide a data management plan that explains how you will make your data available. But unfortunately, up to today, there is nothing about software. Okay, it's kind of a forgotten pillar of science there. So what about software? Are we doing things properly about reproducibility of science when software is involved? Well, I had a very, very, very long list of horror stories. So I have them from physics, from chemistry, from social sciences. But today I will be very politically correct, and so I will tell you only horror stories of my own discipline, which is computer science, okay? So let's start. After all, we are computer scientists. We should be the one who know how to do this well. Huh? Well, let's have a look. You know, a few years ago, people in computer science started to get worried about the issue of reproducing the results which are presented in the article we actually published. And a colleague from the States, Christian Kolberg, set up a nice experiment that you can reproduce and verify, by the way. I mean, so see, he took 613 papers from the top conference in the journal in applied computer science. Let me open a parenthesis here. In computer science, most of our prestigious publications are in conferences, not in journals. It's a long story, but just trust me. So these are really the most important places. And he was just asking a basic question, which was, okay, let's take these papers. They report the result obtained using some software. Can we get the source code of the software described in the paper, compile it, and run it? They are not asking whether the result is still 42. They are just asking for the ability to compile and run the source code. So he set up a workflow. Here you see this long, complex workflow where basically saying we start looking at the article. If the article is theoretical, then drop it. If the article requires some special hardware, then drop it. In the other cases, look at the article. Try to find the source code using the information in the article. If you cannot find it there, go to the web page of the authors and try to find the software doing that. If you don't find it there, then, write to the authors. If they don't answer, write again. If they answer, write again. If they don't answer, stop. Okay, basically, that was the process. So now the big question, I hope you didn't pick my other slide. The big question is, how many of these papers pass the test? What do you think? These are the top conferences in applied computer science. 50? 10%? 600. 50%. 50%. 10%? Let me give you the answer. So this is actually the breakdown of what is going on. So you have initially these 600 papers, so there are non-theoretical 63, non-applied, I mean, there is no software, 63 papers, you drop them, then there are 30 that require special hardware, you drop them, so you are left with more or less 500 papers. Of the 500 papers, you finally manage to get the source code by one of the different means, the article, the web pages, the mail from the author, on 226 articles. 9 of them file to build, they do not even build. And then at the end, you have basically 200 and something which are running. All the others, you cannot even get the source code. Either because people don't answer, either because you get answered. I mean, if you have nothing to do on a weekend, I do suggest you Google up this Christian Kohlberg article. You look especially at the appendix of the technical report, because there are something like 30 pages of sample exchanges of the email. Some example, like, for example, the cat ate my software. I mean, what do you mean? Well, my Mac was laying here on the desk, and the cat jumped on the desk and pushed the machine on the floor, and the disk crashed. I do not have access to the software anymore.
Excuse me, let me ask you something. I mean, so I suppose we consider irrelevant papers, right?
Yes.
Not an irrelevant paper.
No, no, no. These are all refereed articles.
No, well, you know, refereed article nowadays is not such a great
task. It's already a test.
No, what I want to say is that it seems to me that if a paper pretends to be relevant, that information must be there. Otherwise, it's not a relevant paper. Full stop.
I'm very happy that you say that. I would sign with two hands under what your statement. No, unfortunately, this is not what the people in academia is doing.
Of sociology now, not of science, right? You see what I mean?
I understand. But give me a few minutes, you will see where we are going. I mean, so the main reason about this, what are the main reasons? You will see the main reasons detailed in the report, but essentially, the main reason is that the source code is no longer available, or the good version of the source code used in the experiment or in the paper cannot be found anymore. So some people answer, well, yes, the code we use in that particular paper, well, I don't remember exactly which one we used, but I found this. Here it is, if you want to use it. You see, it's not writing. And so this is really unsatisfactory and brings me to my original point. So if you really want to preserve and to exchange information about scientific results, we need the papers, we need the data, we need the software, and we need to make these things properly related. So in an article, you should have a pointer to the precise version of the software which was used and to the precise version of the data set which was used. And if you are producing a data set using a particular version of the software, you should have an information in the metadata telling you this data set has been produced in this particular case. And there are a lot of interesting things in astrophysics you can dig up, where actually the data which was stored was not the raw data, but the data after a filter was passed, and this particular numerical filter actually resulted in hiding precious information. Oh, this is modern science is very complicated. So you need to have all this. And the point is that, unfortunately, today, you have already seen where I'm going, if you look around with this kind of mindset, you will find out that the situation is really not ideal. There is a really inconvenient truth in front of us. First of all, yes, software is a pillar of open science, but it is a forgotten pillar of open science. First of all, there is no universal catalog of all pieces of software out there. There are many places where you can find the source code. There are platforms, development platforms we use to develop source code. For example, when I was younger, everybody was on some place which was called SourceForge. The young guys today do not even know what it is. I mean, it has been forgotten for a while. Today, everybody is on GitHub, but GitHub has been there only for 10 years. I mean, 10 years ago, it was not even existing. And there are so many other places where we found the software. And then if you are an old guy like me and you have been working with students and postdocs for a while, you know that when you have a new student or a new postdoc coming in, they basically come to you and say, hey, Robert, you are still on SourceForge. No, this has been. You must absolutely be on this new fancy platform that everybody uses. So you take your stuff from out of SourceForge, you put it in a new platform. Then somebody else comes and say, you are still using CVS. You should use Subversion. So you learn another version control system, you convert into another thing. So after a while, your software is really spread around, it's moving different places. That's not good. The other point we found out, unfortunately, a few years ago, is that we do not have an archive. What is an archive? It's not the same thing as a development platform. A development platform is a place where people work together to develop a piece of software. An archive is a place where you put a piece of software, and you come back later, I mean, 2 years, 3 years, 20 years, and you find it again. Because you have a pointer, you still find it.
Public archive? Public or?
Public or private, depends on what you want to do. But today, you don't have any public archive, and you don't have many private archive either. That's the big issue. And the point is that software is fragile, and we have discovered it 3 years ago when two of the many platforms which are popular in the moment, Google Code and Gitorius, has been shut down in March 2015. Okay, so on Google Code, there were 1,500,000 projects developed collaboratively, and on Gitorius, there were 120,000 projects developed collaboratively. And these platforms were shut down. So this is kind of new, because you know that you can have a disk that fails. But having a business decision taken by somebody in the States that decide to shut down a platform where you have millions of software developers, this is definitely new. Okay? And there you understand that we don't have an archive. And finally, the other thing is that we do not have a research infrastructure. I mean, today's software is really fundamental in our society, and you would expect that as a community of computer scientists, or as a community, or as mankind, we make the effort to build an infrastructure that allows us to study the source code, which is embedded in the phone, which is embedded in pacemakers, in transportation systems, in financial systems, to make sure there are as few errors, as few mistakes as possible in that software. And well, the bad news is, no, there is no such infrastructure. And it gets worse. When you look at the situation in science in general, there is a big lack of recognition about the importance of software as a pillar of open science. For example, I don't know if some of you know about this EOSC, the European Open Science Cloud, which is a big European project to provide an infrastructure for open science. Today, you can take the PDF file that describes the project written by the Commission. It is many dozens of pages. You do Control F and search for software. The word software appears once in all the document in a side note. So this is kind of strange, in 2019. Then there is a European copyright reform that is taking place right now in Brussels. In this European copyright reform, there are a couple of articles which are extremely damaging for software development today. This has been written not by people that hate software. Everybody loves software today. It has been written by people that know nothing about software. And so they just naively put into rules that are negative for software development. It has taken an incredible amount of time to me and other people to go and talk to politicians in different places to try to explain to them. And explain what is software to people who has never seen a line of code, I can tell you it's not an easy fit. The other point is that if you're a researcher and you are really willing to do the best to make your software available, and you look for guidance, you will see that there is no guidance today. There is no guidance on how to choose a license on the piece of software you are making available. There is no guidance on how to cite a piece of software properly, which is not the same as actually providing, this is a long story. I mean, how to cite a software project, how to make the software source code actually available or archive it, how to use or relate to industry best practices, because, you know, software, I mean, scientific articles are the scientific community, but software is not just the scientific community. The scientific community is a very tiny little part of the software developers. The rest of the world is developing software. So we cannot just invent new things or reinvent the wheel. We should follow what is going on in the other places. So all this is a very unfortunate situation. And if you look at the situation today, it's a really important moment. So we are at a turning point because the situation I have described to you is not new. It's been there for a long time. So why now is a special moment? Now it is a special moment because looking at the past, we are in the moment where we can still go back and talk to the people that invented computer technology and ask them why software was developed in a particular way and collect this information. I would like to talk to be talk to Galileo or to Archimede or something like that. They are dead. But for computer science, you can still talk to these people. You can go back and collect this information. And if you look at the future, there has been never been so much people developing software as today. So it's really important to fix these issues as soon as possible, because every 30 months, the amount of new software developed doubles. Okay? So if you do not build catalogs and infrastructures and archives, the problem is getting worse in an exponential way. That's the reason why we decided 4 years ago to start an initiative which is called Software Heritage. And so after the bad news, let me try to bring you some hope about the future. Software Heritage is an initiative that has a precise mission to actually go out and collect all source code that they've written, preserve it, make sure we don't lose it, and make it easily accessible and reusable by other people. So this is not about just preserving old software. It is much more than that. It is about following closely the software development of today and building an infrastructure that allows us to build better software, to have a better future. So if you want to build something like this, how can you go about it? Well, first of all, you sit down and think. I mean, you do not create a new infrastructure in 2 seconds. So we set up some kind of basic founding principles, and we decided to create just a single infrastructure that collects, preserves, and shares source code, but nothing else. You know, I am an old Unix guy, and when you are a Unix guy, you remember there is a mantra which is develop tools that do one thing and one thing well and make sure it interconnects with the other tools, so the famous shell pipe. Okay? So the idea here is to have this infrastructure that will help build applications for industry, for research, for education, for cultural heritage, but we are not going to build any of these applications. We are only building the infrastructure on top of which other people will build this application. And the other thing, if you go to make an effort like building such an infrastructure, there is a risk that you spend a lot of effort in something that will die or will be lost in the future. So we decided to follow the advice of the fourth president of the United States, Thomas Jefferson, who is also the person who created the first network of public libraries in the States. You know, this comes from a letter that in those periods people actually wrote letters in a very sophisticated way. So somebody from the revolution in the United States sent to Thomas Jefferson a precious document which was saved from a fire, and asking him, what can we do? Because this is a precious information of our history. And Jefferson was answering, well, what is burned is burned. You can do anything. But for the rest, to save it, instead of locking it in vaults that will hide it from the public, we should make so many copies that no accident can actually destroy any of them. And this is basically, if you do computer science today, if you take a course on resilient, highly available infrastructure, that's reliable infrastructure 101, okay? Making copies of the thing. That's the reason why we're trying to build a common infrastructure which mutualizes resources. Everything we do is open source, so you can copy what we do. It is non-for-profit, so we cannot be bought by a company and shut down. We are creating a program for a mirror network, that is to say, don't just trust me. Make a copy and run a mirror somewhere else. And if you actually follow this project properly, this may prevent a useless diaspora, the useless diaspora that we have seen, for example, in open access. Open access was a beautiful idea 20 years ago, but the implementation was a disaster, because if you see, every institution has its own repository of open access papers. So again, you do not have a catalog, you do not have an archive, you have many archives. So let's try to avoid making the same mistakes away.
But the issue, isn't it the universality?
Absolutely. That's exactly the point. I mean, if we want to avoid creating a useless diaspora, I should absolutely refrain from building an archive or just a software in computer science. Then you have somebody who will do an archive for the software in physics, and then an archive of software in chemistry. And what's the point? Do you really want to have an internet for physicists, an internet for chemistry, an internet for biologists, and an internet for the home? And no, let's say one internet and build different applications on top of that. So let me get there. So this actually, doing this work over the 4 years that we have spent on this, we ended up discovering that what we are building is actually a revolutionary infrastructure, both for open science, but also for industry. If you look at industry, well, actually, we are building this infrastructure in a very, very special way. Software is a complex object, and the source code of software is actually developed using version control system that actually can be represented as a form of a graph. So we do not take a piece of software in a different drawer. We actually put everything together in a single graph. And actually, we are building the graph of software development. If you think a bit about the revolution that we have witnessed in the past with the big multinational that appeared, there are all revolutions about graphs. Google is a multinational that built a business model around the graph of the web. Facebook built a business model around the graph of the social network. We are building the graph of software development, but we are not building a multinational. On top of this, we are trying to build an international foundation, which is kind of different. And the other thing, the graph we are building is very special. We will spend a few minutes on it later on. It's not just a graph whatsoever. It's a graph which is built using technology which is the same that you find in Bitcoin, blockchain, distributed file system, distributed version control system. So what we are actually building is essentially a blockchain of software development that allows you to trace every single piece of software in a very precise way with unforgeable identifiers, which are there for forever, okay, based on cryptographic technology. And the other point is that if you look at research and innovation, now we are building this missing pillar, I mean, the archive of open source code which is used in research. And actually, we have opened in France in September a mechanism that allows people to deposit source code in an open access portal. In France, they have only one, which is called HAL. And this software goes to Software Heritage, which is where it is stored, and gets these unique identifiers. And we are working with other people to do the same. And then the other important part, which is really interesting, is that we are actually building a reference platform for massive analysis and machine learning on the history of software development. Because for the goal of preservation, the reason we will see this in a slide, we use a technology that actually normalizes the history of development of software, and this is the first phase that you need when you do machine learning. Data normalization is really necessary. You do it not for doing machine learning, but for being there for the long term. The nice side effect, the key school effect, is that we also have a platform for what we in our community call big code. I mean, big data analysis, machine learning on code. So let me give you some numbers. I mean, this is a general vision. Let's open up the hood and see what happens behind it. Today, Software Heritage has already archived the software that comes from over 85 million different software origins. And a software origin is a place where you can find a piece of software. Doesn't mean there are 85 million projects, because you know today in the open source, a lot of people copy the project of others. I mean, so there are, in these 85 million, there are a lot of copies. But then, this boils down to over 5 billion unique source code files, and now these are unique because the data structure we use actually they duplicate massively. So the very same source file is counted only once. We have already ingested, indexed, and we track daily GitHub, Debian, GitLab. The old Google code has been recovered after it was shut down. It was a long story, also this, not easy to get it. GitOrios has been recovered. All the history of GNU, now some scientific software coming from HAL, our own forge in area, which is GitLab, is indexed. We recently announced that we have indexed everything which is in PyPy, which is a Python general archive, over 1.5 million projects. So this is, just to tell you, it's a lot. It's not everything, but it's already a lot. And thanks to the technology we use, this is only 200 terabytes of compressed data. And my friends in physics, you will just laugh at me, because if the tiniest experiment at CERN takes up much more than that. And so you have all the history of development of software from the beginning of mankind. It is just a few hundred terabytes. And then the database, or the graph, is over 6 terabytes of data with 10 billion nodes and 100 million edges, I mean, which is kind of one of the largest public graphs which are available today. So today, this is really the richest public source code archive, and it is growing daily. I mean, I'm a bit too long than what I should be. Let me explain to you a little bit the technicalities. It is not that easy to build such a thing as this kind of archive, okay? Because there are many places where people develop software, GitHub, GitLab, SourceForge, many other places. And unfortunately, all of these places use different protocols, different APIs. There is no standard. It is not like building a web archive, because there is no HTTP for software development forges. So GitHub has an event API, GitLab has another event API. So we have to build adapter for each of these and bring the information in a uniform way. Once we do this, we discover that there are projects which are developing using a very popular tool today, which is called Git, but there are projects developed using other version control systems like Subversion and CVS, RCS, Dax, Mercurial, Bazaar. Otherwise, it is not fun. Okay, they are all different. So for preserving this information in the long term, what we actually do, we are not happy in just making a copy of these contents. We actually convert it into a uniform representation, into one single gigantic Merkle direct acyclic graph, okay, where all the different history of development, no matter the tool you use to maintain them, are all encoded in a standardized way. Okay. And this means that the full development history of this project is all permanently archived in this particular representation. And beware, this is not my invention. We just used the best of breed technology that was available when we started the project. That comes basically from industry. After 30 years of research in computer science, maybe because Berkeley is 1979, okay? So it took a lot of time to get to mainstream industry. Okay. So let's skip this. Few minutes to see it? No, I don't know. I will leave you the slide so you can see how this actually works. And I prefer to move to a short demo of how you can use this archive, because I think it's much better to have a look at how things work. So you can get to this, this is maximizing, okay. You can go to the website here. This is our website, www.softwareedge.org. This is basically a front shop. You see very nicely done to make the American guys happy about our communication. But if you click on the archive button here, you get to a more interesting part where you can actually look at the contents. And here you see the numbers are actually up to date here. This one. See, there are today, there are 5,300,075,000 and counting source files coming from over 86 million project origins. And you can do something like, for example, searching. What about the source code of the Apollo 11? You remember the lady there? So here is the source code of the Apollo 11. We can go in there in Luminary, for example. There is a file that I like a lot. I mean, this burn, baby burn here. Where is a plus on this keyboard? So this code is really fantastic. It is a master ignition routine. I mean, so the software which is run to fire up the rockets in the lunar module. And then you find these kind of beautiful pieces. Here the developers are saying, look, this piece of code is using to actually implement the LEM programs P12, P40, P42. P61, P63. And this is implemented in a special way. It is the same routine, but the parameters are tables that change depending on the program, which is not necessarily a very elegant way of doing things. But again, you are on a specifically constrained machine. And so you see these guys, Adler and Ives, who actually implemented this, they say, look, This routine was conceived and executed. In the 60s, executed was the term using for implemented today. Okay? And then they say, on y soit qui mal y pense. And, you know, shame on you if you think badly of my code. I mean, try to do better on this kind of machine. And then there are, here start the tables for the initial routine, and very properly, in old Latin, they say, noli se tangere. Don't touch it unless you know what you are doing. I mean, these are, there are lives at stake, okay? So you find these kind of beautiful things, and again, these are in the comments, so if you have the binaries, you don't see it. Imagine now that you want to share this information with some friends of yours. You can click here, shift-click there, then you can open this permalink side here, and here there is something really important that I would like to share with you, since we are all scientists. You see this code here, SWH1CNT, etc. This is a cryptographic hash of the file content that you have seen. That is to say, this is an identifier which is intrinsic to the piece of code you are writing. You do not need an external authority to check that this is what you want. So if you share it with a friend, and you can add some decorator, like, for example, I want to tell you what are the line numbers, etc., you can copy the identifier, then you can go to any kind of resolvers. And now let me see if I know how to do this. Yes. Okay, you can paste it, put it in a paper, put in a Twitter feed or something like this, and then you go back exactly to the same place. And it will be the same place because SoftwareEdge is an archive, not in a development platform. So what is in now, it will stay there. You see, and this is something I wanted to do a lot of time ago, and I couldn't do it because I didn't know where to put my software. And since I'm an old guy, you know, I have always been interested in doing open science before the term was actually coined. For example, take this very old paper of mine, 2012, written with a colleague from the University of Pisa, Marco Danieluto. This was a very nice implementation, very nifty implementation of MapReduce. Exploited some particularity of the Unix kernel. So you see this is a typical paper in applied computer science. At some moment you see the source code, let me get to the source code, I mean. So the nifty part was that the MapReduce was implemented using only 29 lines of code. I mean, these 29 lines of code, which are explained in the paper. And then, at the end of the paper, we said, look, all this is available. Experiments, let's go down. Fine. So you see here at the end, it was the full source code of the ParMap library is available under the LGPL license from gitoris.org/ParMap. So that's a place where you can find it. The idea was that now you click on it and you find your software. That was the intention. Now I can click on it. And now, Gitorius has gone. So what should we do? Which is kind of unfortunate. Now, you know, luckily, I'm sorry. We have recovered all the content of Gitorius in Software Heritage. So if you look there, we'll actually find the source code with all its history. So if I go back in time sufficiently, I get an error in the system. Well, let's see this. Okay, now it's working. Network is not perfect. But now, so for example, I can go actually to the status of the source when I submitted the paper. You see, there is proper attribution of the authors here, and the 29 lines I was mentioning to you are exactly here. Okay. And with the proper links that I have shown to you, if it were, they were in the paper, I would be exactly there in the right moment. See? So this is really concrete. It is not no longer a slideware. It's really something you can use. Now, let me try to finish because I'm taking up a lot of time. So how do I do this? Control something L? No? Yes. Let's move on quite quickly. So you can play with the system right now. And just to tell you how we are doing to build this for the long term, forgetting for the technicalities for a moment, first of all, we need awareness of the importance of what we are trying to do. So the first step was to actually go up to the political level. So in April 3rd, last year, 2017, at the UNESCO headquarters, my institution in reassigned an agreement with UNESCO in the presence of the former president of the French Republic, 400 dignitaries coming from all the countries, and this agreement is about long-term preservation and access to software source code, not just scientific one, old source code. And last November, we convened again to UNESCO 40 experts from worldwide to work 2 days, 2 full days on software source code, what is the role, the scope, the importance, and the blockers and the enablers for recognizing the role of source code in our society today. The report will be out, I do hope, by Christmas, as a kind of a Christmas gift. And then the other point was to have learned societies and different associations supporting what we do, finding money, this costs money. There is almost no public money in here, apart the one from INRIA, which is a French state. And you have big companies like Microsoft, Intel, Google, Nokia, GitHub, supporting what we are doing. But also universities, the University of Bologna, University of Quebec, at Montreal, and other institutions joining forces with us. We are establishing a collaboration with Quant to build a source code search engine for the source code. We have the first independent mirror. We signed the agreement last week with a Swedish company, so there will be a first independent mirror in Sweden the next year. And you see, all this in just 4 years. But computer science is an interesting place, and computer technology is an interesting place. 4 years is a geological era in computing, right? So it's important to move fast, because otherwise you become irrelevant. And so if I can conclude here, I think you can help, and the reason I'm very happy to tell you about this is that I can just give you the tip of the iceberg, some ideas of the technology we are building, why we are doing this, why it is relevant for open science, but there are an incredible amount of scientific challenges coming just from building this infrastructure. So how do we have efficient storage of these objects? You know, there are very special ones. So the average size of a source code file is 3 kilobytes. And current file systems are not optimized for more small size. I mean, if you take a Unix machine, the page size is 4 kilobytes. So if you have one file which is 1 byte, it takes up 4 kilobytes. Okay, so it's how do you do this properly? Machine learning, classification, how do you classify, how do you find the interesting software among 80 million different software origins? Now you have deep learning, you have machine learning tools which are modern and available today. Can we use them on this kind of infrastructure? How do you do graph queries efficiently? How do you build mirror protocols which are efficient, fast, and secure, and safe in the long term? And many, many other questions like this. And let me make you a preview announcement. Now it is video. I mean, this is taped, but we have made an agreement with Amazon to make the full data set in Software Heritage available for researchers to play with. So you can do experiments on machine learning on all this data set. And this should be out in a couple of months. I was thinking, not easy to set up, but we will make it available. The other thing, you can contribute to the code. I mean, everything is open source and available in there. It takes a little bit of time to get into the code, but I mean, the community is starting to move fast forward. You can become a sponsor if you have a friend who has some millions to spare. We know how to use it. I mean, you can use the system and tell the system that it is there. So there are many, many ways of contributing. So let me finish by just a final slide. So I think we are in a special moment where we can build and infrastructure, which is at the same time a library of Alexandria of all the source code ever written, and a kind of CERN. I'm very jealous of my friends in physics, because you were able to build something like CERN, and we didn't. We were not able yet to build something like CERN for software. I do hope we'll be able to build something like a CERN for software, for building better software for science and for industry. So if you don't know what to do with your spare time, just join the revolution, and the doors are open for everybody. And thanks a lot for your attention.
First of all, thank you for a really interesting and fascinating presentation. I have a technical question. So in this graph, what are the nodes and what are the edges? Also, I know what a directed acyclic graph is. What is a Merkle directed acyclic graph?
Yeah. So can we go back to this a second? Let me see if I can give you the example. If we can put the slides back. You see, this graph, the graph we are building is like this one. So what are the nodes? You have the leaves. The leaves of the graph are the contents of the file, not the file with their name, just the contents of the file. And then the internal nodes are representations of the directories, representation of the commits, representation of the releases. So let me make it very simple, explicit. Imagine you have one file content, this one, which happens to be the text of the general public license version 3. You can compute on this text file a few cryptographic hashes, namely SHA-1, SHA-256, SHA-1 git, etc. Then you can pick one of these hashes. We actually use a SHA-1 git today. And this hash is a representation of that particular content, because it is a cryptographic hash, and so the chances of having a collision are vanishingly small. So that's really a representation of your file. Now imagine that this file, so this key precisely identify this particular content. Now imagine that this content has a name in a directory. You can find it in a directory, a file which is called license that has this content. Well, you can represent the directory as a text file where each line is the name of the file, for example, here, license. Let me see if it works. I mean, license, then the hash that points exactly to the object, then some meta information like the fact that it's a binary object and some rights, and then the sequence of these lines represents a directory, but it is again a text file. So on a text file, you can compute again a hash. You see this green hash here. And this can be used in other text files that represent directories until you get to a revision. Revision is another text file that says the status of the development and the previous version and the commit log. And then with just one key, you can precisely represent a full subgraph. This is a Merkle graph. So the pointer to the root represents a full graph in a way which is unforgeable. Okay? But at the same time, since you are using these keys, a representation of subgraphs, if you have two projects with the same exact subgraph, you only store them once. And you use a key in place. And the compression factor we have is 300. So without that technology, instead of 200 terabytes, it would be 60 petabytes. So better to use this, right?
Oh, hi. I was wondering, how far back are you going with the codes? Because I'm thinking at the Museum of Computing Machinery here, and there is plenty of material from the 50s, which is, of course, not electronic, just stored. Absolutely. And on paper, quite often fragmentary also. So, I mean, this one is clearly an interesting issue, like you were saying, for the Apollo 11 mission.
Yeah, it's a very good question. But so this brings me to whole other sector of the strategy we have developed. We really are building software heritage, all software, not only free software, not only modern software, also old software. But if you want to really have all the software ever written, then first of all, you need to classify what you are trying to handle. And there are basically two dimensions. One dimension is it easy to get a copy of that software or not? So basically, we have online software, which is easily accessible on a website somewhere, and offline software on punched cards, on old floppies, on printouts. I mean, you know, the Apollo 11 was on a printout in the library of MIT, and somebody actually typed it, okay? So it was not already digital. And then you have another dimension, which is legal. So do I need to talk to a lawyer to get a copy of the software, or can I avoid to talk to the lawyer to get the software? So the machinery we have built right now is basically for online open software where you can have automation. But we are really targeting everything. So for example, we also want the source code of MS-DOS, which is luckily already available, but of Windows 10, of Mac Paint, of Eudora, et cetera, which is offline and closed. So you need to talk to lawyers and you need to find the place where the software is and read it from tapes or something like that. But we are not doing that ourselves. We are partnering with institutions like the Computer History Museum, other institutions that can do that. And for example, everybody that has old software that they want to make it available, it is possible to deposit it already in Software Heritage today. There are three different ways of doing this, but we can talk about this later.
Question?
This concept really reminds me of the Wayback Machine.
It is.
So, in fact, the websites are also a form of source code, basically. So I wanted to ask you, are you using the experience of Wayback, or maybe this technology could be also used for by Wayback? We could be possible to make some sort of larger collaboration.
A very, very good question. So we went to San Francisco to the headquarters of the Internet Archive a few years ago with Jean-François Grammatic, which is one of my advisors, and he was the first director of the W3C. So I mean, he's a wise man, older than me, that can give some advice. So we went to talk to Brewster Carl, who is the founder of the Internet Archive, and we really do want to have a collaboration, but actually, technically, what we are doing is very, very, very different. So his approach on the Wayback Machine back in the 90s, I mean, it was starting in 96 and then opened up in 98, as far as I remember, is to store each copy of each website in a separate directory on a separate disk, with the idea that if you lose a disk, you just lose a bunch of websites, but you don't lose the rest. So, for example, if you have an image or a web page which is extremely popular in the web, it is stored millions of times in different places. Our approach is completely different. We really want to keep track of this graph explicitly and to deduplicate everything. So the two technologies are really not the same. But we hope to have a collaboration up soon. Basically, you know, when I store a piece of software, I know that there is information on a website, I can ask the Wayback Machine to store that web page and having a link. But this requires some time. It is not immediately our top priority today.
More question? Yeah.
Ah. Per Paolo? Hello.
I was thinking about recovering the software using the old addresses. Are you thinking of building an indirection table where you can input with the old address and get to the...
Yes, yes, it is already there, actually. If you saw what I did in the demo before, if you know that a piece of software was in a particular place at a moment in time, we had the same interface as the Wayback Machine, so you can put the URL of the place where the software was, and we can show you how many times you have visited the particular origin and what was the state of the particular origin at the moment in time, which is particularly important when you do software development using modern tools like Git, because Git keep tracks of the history of software development, but you can change this history which is stored. I mean, for people who are hackers, you remember Git rebase, minus E, et cetera, and then you try to push, and it is not what you should do, but you usually do Git push minus force, and it goes on. So there is a lot of software, the history has been, changed. And that's the reason why it is really important for us to keep the state at different moment in time, and it is cheap for us because we only keep links, you know? So if it didn't change, it costs nothing. If it changed a little, we only pay the difference in the part that changed.
There is something that puzzles me about the future. You know that programs tend to be interactive and reactive and self-modifying, unpredictably modifying. And so how can you cast this sort of programs in your wonderful project, by the
way? Thanks, Pier Paolo. So then it's an interesting question that brings me, give me the occasion of clarifying a little bit more what we are doing. We are building an archive only for source code. So we do not pretend to be able to make this software runnable again. The only thing that is important for me is to make sure that you can read it. But in a piece of software, if you find in this particular piece of software a call to a Google API, so that's another story. So we do not pretend to maintain software in a state of runnability or executability, because this is a super difficult problem that nobody knows how to handle properly. Different people, even if it's, you know, in different places, people are using virtual machine, Docker files, and this and that. Everybody thinks they have the silver bullet. Let me say that I still do not believe it. So I prefer to spend my time on something where I know how to do it. I mean, it's difficult, but at least I know how to do it, instead of running after this holy grail of full reproducibility, which is, I believe, still a little bit out of reach.
We have time for one more question. There is one. Okay. Yeah.
So I find the idea of the CERN of the software very fascinating. But how do you envisage it? So how does it work?
Well, the point is that you see, the first. I mean, of course, CERN is different because you have a single place where you're doing this kind of experiment in a place that cannot be reproduced in other places. But you already have something similar, you know, around CERN. When you have the data around CERN, it is spread around in Europe in different places in the world, around different places, and you do run analysis in different places. So what I'm looking forward to, is an infrastructure like this one. So a common crawler that gets all the data efficiently, which is not easy. I mean, I said before, every 2.5 years, the amount of new software, not the copies, we fork, doubles, which is a challenge. So we need to cope with this kind of exponential growth. But then when we have the data, ideally, you can imagine a university, a research center, a company, an industry in different places. They all have a mirror, a full mirror of the data, and they run experiments. They know how to run locally on their copy of the data, and then they share this information. This is my vision of what could be a CERN of software. See, but you have the same API, the same interface, so you know that the different software tools you're running will all be interchangeable on this data set, instead of having different incompatible data set all around. Not easy, but I do hope we will make it.
Okay, so let's thank again Professor Di Cosmo. There is a refreshment in the corridor. So
on the other side of the corridor.